Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger. Let's have a look today at trigonometry expressed in terms of quadrants and spread. These are the two concepts that we've been talking about in the last few videos, and they simplify trigonometry enormously. So I remind you that if we have a point, it's represented by a pair of rational numbers x and y. And a line is represented by a proportion, A to B to C, also of rational numbers. The quadrance between two points, A1 and A2, is the difference between the x-coordinate squared plus the difference in the y-coordinate squared. And the spread between two lines, L1 and L2, is given by this expression in the coordinates A1, B1, C1, and A2, B2, C2. It's a1 b2 minus a2 b1 all squared divided by a1 squared plus b1 squared times a2 squared plus b2 squared. Now in a picture, a diagram, we may have points a1, a2, and a3. We represent the quadrances of the sides by little bars q1, q2, and q3. So notice that q1 is usually opposite a1, Q2 is opposite A2, and Q3 is opposite A3. And the spreads made by the pairs of lines are S1, S2, and S3. One other thing that we need to remember is the formula for the line joining two points. So if we have a point X1, Y1, and another point X2, Y2, then the line joining them, denoted A1, A2, is given by this proportion, Y1 minus Y2, to x2 minus x1 to x1 y2 minus x2 y1. So when we say the spread S1, we're really talking about the spread between a1 and a2 and a1 a3. Let's have a look at a particular example where we can actually compute the quadrances and spreads for three particular points. So here are three particular points. A1 is 1, 0, A2 is 3, 5, and A3 equals 4, 2. So to illustrate how relatively easy it is to compute with these quantities, let's calculate the quadrances first. The quadrance Q1 is the quadrance between A2 and A3. So we look at the difference between the x-coordinates, and we square it, and then we look at the difference between the y-coordinates, and we square that as well, and we add them. So we have 1 squared plus 3 squared equals 10. Similarly, Q2 is 13, and Q3 is 29. To calculate the spreads, we first need to calculate the lines joining these two points. So how do we calculate A1, A2? Well, we look at the coordinates for A1 and A2, and we look at Y1 minus Y2, that's the first coordinate, then X2 minus X1, that's the second coordinate, and then the last one is the product 1 times 5 minus the product 3 times 0, for a total of 5. And now we can check that this is the line going through these two points by checking that 1 times minus 5 plus 0 times 2 plus 5 is 0. And that 3 times minus 5 plus 5 times 2 plus 5 is also 0. In a similar way, I'll let you check that A1, A3 is minus 2 to 3 to 2, and A2, A3 is the line 3 to 1 to minus 14. And now to calculate the spread, S1 say, which will be the spread between the two lines going through the point A1. We need to calculate the spread between these two lines. What do we do? This times this minus this times this. So that's minus 15 plus 4, all squared in the numerator. And in the denominator, 5 squared plus 2 squared, and minus 2 squared plus 3 squared, for a total of 121 over 29 times 13, which is 121 over 377. In a similar way, S2, you can check, is 121 over 290, and S3 is 121 over 130. Now, if we had given these same three points to a classical trigonometer and asked them to calculate the distances and the angles, and we only gave them a piece of paper and a pen, we would be here all day and all week and all half a year, because you can't actually calculate these angles completely correctly. You can only calculate truncations or approximations to them. And if we say require 10-digit approximations, then by hand, even a professional mathematician would probably require most of a day to find the angles and the distances for a triangle like this, showing that this system is not only much more logical, but it's also much more practical for actual calculations. And now let's get to the main laws of trigonometry. There are five. Two of them we've already talked about. They are Pythagoras' theorem and the triple quad formula. Now let's have a look at the other three main laws of trigonometry. The main laws concern a general triangle which has quadrances Q1, Q2, Q3 and spreads S1, S2, S3 as we were talking about in the previous two slides. There are three main laws, the spread law, the cross law, and the triple spread formula. These are laws that connect these six numbers to each other. The first of the laws is the spread law. It's telling us that S1 divided by Q1 equals S2 divided by Q2 equals S3 divided by Q3. This is the rational analog of the sine law. It does not require any transcendental functions, however. Only rational arithmetic is required. The next law is the cross law, which is probably the most important of all the laws. It expresses a spread in terms of the three other quadrances. So it's Q1 plus Q2 minus Q3 all squared equals 4 times Q1 times Q2 times 1 minus S3. And that's only one of three possible cross laws. You could vary this by interchanging the indices 1, 2, and 3. So you'd also get a corresponding one with an S2 here and another one with an S1 here. This is the analog, the rational analog of the cosine law. And finally, there's a relationship between the three spreads of a triangle. This is called the triple spread formula, and it tells us that the sum S1 plus S2 plus S3 all squared is 2 times the sum of the squares, S1 squared plus S2 squared plus S3 squared, plus an additional cubic term, 4 times S1, S2, S3. And this is the rational analog of the fact that the sum of three angles in a triangle adds up to that magical number, pi. With these three laws and Pythagoras' theorem and the triple quad formula, and I remind you that the triple quad formula is essentially this part of the triple spread formula, so there's a lot of connections between these laws. These five laws allow us to solve the majority of trigonometric problems. That's a big claim, and if you are more interested in seeing how that works, I suggest that you look at my WildTrig series, also a YouTube series. That explains how rational trigonometry really does change our point of view towards geometry and calculations. How do we prove these laws? Because after all, we're interested in a purely logical development of mathematics, so we want to make sure that all of our laws are nailed down completely. Well, that's actually very easy to do, because all of these laws are purely algebraic expressions. And so if we have three points, x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, then it's purely a matter of labor to convert each one of these laws into a big identity involving those six variables. And so you can easily check these laws if you have a computer just by making the computer calculate both sides of these expressions and then verifying that they're actually the same. Next time we're going to have a look at circles and how to look at them completely logically and clearly. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.